In South America, oil companies have enlisted armies to help protect their interests, and until recently, that practice was limited to third world countries. But today, that practice has come to North America, and I have author and Ring of Fire co-host Bobby Kennedy with me now to talk about it. Bobby, the militarization of the pipeline, no surprise to you. You've been following this story since day one. But I think the American public doesn't understand exactly what's happening, and that is that they have focused this issue, the corporate America, and they have figured out that if they can vilify activists and make activists look like terrorists and criminals, they win. Lay the story out for us, if you would.
Well, the twist on this story, Mike, is that in this case, and we've seen this happening for two decades, but in this case, a local group called Bold Nebraska, which is made up of Nebraska ranchers and farmers and activists, sent a Freedom of Information request to the federal government and the state police agencies, and they were able to find documentation that TransCanada, which is the Canadian company that is building the XL Keystone Pipeline, is actually training federal law enforcement officials and federal law and state of Nebraska state troopers to fight and battle and investigate and criminalize and marginalize environmental activists who might want to express their opinion against the pipeline. As I've said to you, this has happened. This is part of a long trend to criminalize and to marginalize environmental activists. We've seen this happen again and again. In 2006, we saw the federal government during the Bush administration pass the Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act, which is an act that makes it a federal crime to interfere with the operations of a factory farm. We've seen this again and again. You know, Pap, you would probably not even believe this if you didn't know it, but as you know, in 17 states, we now have laws that are called food libel or veggie libel laws that make it illegal to criticize the operations of a factory farm, and in some cases, to actually photograph a factory farm or a factory farm animal from a public road. You may say to yourself, and I think most Americans who hear this will say, that's nonsense. We have a First Amendment in this country. There's no state legislator, much less legislature, that's reckless or crazy enough to try to pass a law that impedes people's capacity to speak against a corporation or to say that food is bad or may not be good for you, may not be nutritious. But ask Oprah Winfrey. Because she had a former factory farmer on her show who criticized factory farming and factory farming meat, and she was prosecuted in the state of Texas. And she had to go to a jury trial, which meant that her entire show and her network had to move their operations to the state of Texas during the pendency of that jury trial. So we're seeing this all over the country. You know, Rich Perlstein has a terrific article in this week's Rolling Stone magazine where he talks about this bifurcation of enforcement. During the Bush administration, the FBI put environmental terrorism as one of their top three threats, internal threats to this country. Environmental terrorists like Earth First have never killed anybody. But there's a lot of other domestic terrorist threats that have, for example, the Oklahoma City bombing, and the kind of right-wing, racist, paramilitary threats that you see in Idaho and Ohio and Michigan and Florida and many other states, anti-abortion activists who've killed many people and set off many bombs. You don't see that in the environmental community.
Bobby, it appears to me that what has happened is that the activist movement has simply been outmaneuvered by Madison Avenue. Madison Avenue has been able to frame the idea that the people who used to be the only people in the way of tearing down our forest, polluting our water, polluting our air, the only people in the way of that were people who were willing to leave their jobs, willing to leave their family, willing to put themselves at great risk to stop all of that. Now, what has happened is Madison Avenue has taken this, they've focused it, they even have the police, they even have the military convinced that people who want to stop something like the XL pipeline are criminals. You actually have been you've been involved in that directly, haven't you? You've been arrested trying to stop this.
Yeah, but I was arrested for doing something that was clearly illegal, and I intended to be arrested. And there's a difference between that. And you know, it's important for Americans and American law enforcement and politicians to understand the difference between deliberate civil disobedience, which I did, which is not terrorism. A terrorist bombs something or destroys property and then sneaks away. Somebody who commits civil disobedience, the rules are well established, you get yourself arrested, you do it peacefully, and you take responsibility for whatever crime that you commit. You try not to damage property or human beings. And that's what we did. But you're right, there's a conflation that Madison Avenue has engineered on behalf of the polluters, the big PR companies that represent the polluters classically, Burstyn, Marcella, and Hill and Knowlton, have very cleverly over the past two decades conflated environmental special interests with public interests. In other words, what they say is, why should we pay attention to the environmentalists? They're just another special interest. They're no different morally or in other respect, patriotically or altruistically or philanthropically than an oil company. But that ignores the distinction between people who are acting for special interests, in other words, to line their own pocketbooks, and people who are acting for the public interest, to make America live up to her ideals and to fight for the cause of justice for the entire community. And that's, you know, that is the difference that has been ignored and glossed over and conflated here. And then now they've gone even further and said that environmental activists are actually terrorists. People who interfere with corporate profit-taking ought to be arrested.
Bobby,
and that is fascism.
Bobby, isn't the very fact that we're having this conversation, how odd it is that we're having a conversation, that a person that wants to save our drinking aquifer from the XL pipeline, that we're having to say, well, you know, they're really not terrorists. The success of it is, the Madison Avenue success is, they've done a good job. Now, let me move to something. There was a slideshow that kind of became part of the public domain through Alternet. It was called the Protester Motivations. And the Protester Motivations was a slideshow that was used by the folks trying to push this pipeline through the middle of America. And the slideshow is to say, how do we get police officers angry at activists? How do we get the military involved with stopping activists? How do we do all those things? That slideshow is revealing, isn't it, Bobby?
Well, yeah, it is, because it essentially demonstrates, it shows how to how the military and it encourages the military, it encourages police and enforcement, the militarized arm of the state, to essentially entrap environmentalists and to view them as the enemy, as the criminal, and the pipeline as the society that they're supposed to protect. It's interesting, you know, in Rich Perlstein's article, he talks about a group in Ohio, an environmental group in Ohio that was a peaceful group, and they were infiltrated by the FBI. The FBI introduced them, the FBI informer actually persuaded them to engage in an act of violence. And he was the leader. They objected, but he browbeat them into doing it. Then he introduced them to a bomb maker. He obtained the bomb for them, and they ended up trying to bomb a small bridge. Meanwhile, at the exact same time, in the state of Florida, a white power group that wants to kill black people and kill politicians who fight for civil rights laws was actually planning a major terrorist attack on our country, and the FBI refused to arrest anybody that had anything to do with it. So you have this bifurcation of enforcement priorities that is really distorted, and it's tilted towards going after people who interfere with corporate profit taking. A minute ago, I used the word fascism, and I don't use that word lightly. I use it according to the dictionary definition of it, which says that it is the merger of state and corporate power. We have to understand, Pap, that the domination of government, of business by government, is called communism. The domination of government by business is called fascism. And what we need to do is walk a narrow trail in between, which is free market capitalism and democracy, and keep big government at bay with our right hand, big business at bay with our left. And what we're seeing now is this extraordinary merger that we have not seen before in American history, except perhaps for a brief time during the 1880s and 1890s, when you did see government military deployed on behalf of big businesses and the Pinkerton strike to machine gun the union organizers and the Blair Mountain strike in 1920.
Bobby,
and we really almost lost democracy at that time. Now you're seeing the same group deployed against environmentalism. And I remember something that Pat Robertson wrote that was picked up by all of the right wing in this country, which is green is the new pink. In other words, the environmental movement is the new enemy that's going to replace communism after 1988, after the fall of the Berlin Wall. And that's what they're trying to do, marginalize environmentalists so that to make us less effective at trying to put the reins in the mouth of these corporations that are running roughshod.
I guess if you the take away from this, I guess on a positive aspect, is that obviously they are concerned about environmental activism. They're concerned to the point to where they came out with this elaborate slideshow about how to deal with activists. The activist that's out there, the activist that's standing in front of the pipeline, the activist that's out there talking about global climate change, clean water, clean air, they actually are having a positive effect. That is very clear when you see what's happening out of Madison Avenue to try to answer all this. Bobby Kennedy, thanks for joining
us. That's the good news, Pap. Thanks a lot for having me.